Hi, everyone. Thank you all for coming out. And thank you also to my learned colleague, Professor Brett Feger, who's a scientist as well as a theologian. It's really a pleasure to be able to collaborate with you. So our talk is titled God, Natural Science, and Beauty. And you may have guessed that we'll be going over some examples of beauty and the natural science. Some of you may be wondering, why should I care about beauty and the natural science? Some might even take it a step further and ask, why should I care about beauty at all? And there might even be some skeptics among you who are wondering, why should I care about anything at all? So I'm going to attempt to answer those three questions. Firstly, why should you care about anything at all? Well, ultimately, you should care about things because they're either they're good, they're true, or they're beautiful. Aquinas called these three things, goodness, truth, and beauty, transcendentals, meaning that they exist to varying degrees in all of creation. So that's why you should care about anything at all. For now, for the second question, why should you care about beauty in particular? Well, I would answer with Fyodor Dostoevsky that beauty will save the world. This quote comes from Dostoevsky's novel, The Idiot, in which a Christ figure wrestles with a world that's sort of very fallen. It's a world gone mad. And the main theme of the book is this question, can beauty save the world? Now, interestingly enough, in that novel, he seems to answer no. Even though beauty is our last best hope, it's not enough. It can't save the world. But he asks and answers this question again in his final novel, The Brothers Karamazov, with a lot more hope. There's some hope that beauty is our last best hope, and therefore beauty can save the world. Now, maybe the opinion of only one bearded Russian novelist isn't enough to convince you all. But these words were reiterated about a century later by Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who, of course, lived through the Soviet Union. He lived in the Gulag, so he also dealt with a world with a lot of oppression. And so I want to read this quote in its entirety to you just because I find it so powerful. So he says, let me see if I can turn the mic on. He says, so perhaps the ancient trinity of truth, goodness, and beauty is not simply an empty, faded formula, as we thought in the days of our self-confident, materialistic youth. If the tops of these three trees converge, as the scholars maintained, but the two blatant, two direct stems of truth and goodness are crushed, cut down, not allowed through, then perhaps the fantastic, unpredictable, unexpected stems of beauty will push through and soar to that very same place, and in so doing, will fulfill the work of all three. In that case, Dostoevsky's remark, beauty will save the world, was not a careless phrase, but a prophecy. So what Solzhenitsyn is saying there is that when we live in a society that suppresses goodness and truth, beauty might be our last best hope to connect us to those two things. Of course, he lived in the Soviet Union, which did a lot of oppression, and so it was understandable that he wanted to find ways to connect to reality. Now, we're not living in the Soviet Union, but our own culture is crazy in its own way. We do live in a culture that denies truth and denies goodness. You can see the denial of truth if you try to go onto a secular campus and call a man and a woman. You can see the denial of goodness when people are encouraged to boast about their abortions. And so we also live in a society that denies goodness and truth. And the hope then is that beauty, which is connected intrinsically with these other two things, might be able to point us to goodness and truth and do the work of all three, as Solzhenitsyn says. So that's why I believe that beauty is important. Now for my final question, why should we care about beauty in the natural sciences? Well, I think partly the reason is because our culture so highly values science. We live in a culture with a materialist philosophy. By that, I mean a culture that denies that there's anything anything beyond matter, nothing spiritual or transcendent. All that exists is matter. And of course, if you accept that worldview, you'll place a very high value on the understanding of matter, hence science. We can see this value of science if you ever drive by someone's house. I've seen a lot of yard signs that say, in this house, we believe in science. Or there was even a public figure who recently justified political policies by saying he represented science. So our culture has a high value placed on science. And so if we can point to instances of beauty in the natural science, it's a very strong apologetical tool. So that's why we should care about beauty in the natural sciences. Now, you may be thinking that perhaps Professor Feger and I are just sort of forcing our views. We're trying to make science be what we want it to be, but not what it really is. So I have three quotes here. I'm not going to read them, but from scientists living in very different centuries who are talking about their experience of beauty in science. And all of them come to almost a spiritual experience in the beauty they see. So we do see that this has been the traditional view of scientists, that there's something beautiful about it, and that beauty can point us to something beyond just the material world. So that's why you should care about beauty in the natural sciences. Now I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Professor Feger, who has, we'll talk about a very interesting paper.
Yeah, so on that last slide, Dr. Sadasivan, we bolded a few key parts. And in this last one, you see logical beauty. And that one is important for where we're headed. And so when we were asked to do this talk, I thought, well, let's just see what's out there on the interwebs about natural science and beauty. So I decided to search it. And lo and behold, I came across a paper that was just published in August of this year, 2022. In Frontiers in Psychology by out of Catholic University of America. There's a sociologist who's the principal investigator here, Brandon Vadyanathan. The paper was entitled Aesthetic Experiences and Flourishing in Science, a Four-Country Study. So this is a very broad study. It's not like they just asked 10 people. They had a really nice sample size. And so then Nature Magazine, which is one of the higher impact factor journals in the entire world, wrote a news article on it, and they entitled it Beauty and Wonder of Science Boosts Researchers' Well-Being. So we'll get to the part about well-being, but already you can see that the aesthetic experience that Vadyanathan and his colleagues were asking about revolves around beauty and then wonder and awe. And then the next thing was that what was really exciting about this paper was that they asked 3,061 physicists and biologists, and I thought, you gotta be kidding me, this is amazing. Like, physicists, biologists, you know, they didn't throw any of the other natural sciences in there. I'm like, this is perfect. And so, this is gonna be the foundation of our talk, what do you think? And so, the one thing that they looked at were about 10 categories on beauty, kind of what are different ways that these physicists and biologists receive or perceive beauty in their work. And so they see things a little bit differently, but overall there was some agreement along some of those categories. And so what we'll do is we're gonna focus, for the sake of time, we're gonna focus on the top two, which were hidden order or patterns, and then inner logic of systems, which is why I wanted to point to the logic of beauty or the beauty of logic in that previous quote. And then the one that they equally disagreed on was asymmetry, which I think most people can understand why something that's asymmetrical is less beautiful than something that's symmetrical, but we're gonna focus on the other two. So as we work through, we're both gonna give examples from our own work in the way that we see these particular categories that the in agreement with the physicists and biologists from the survey.
All right, so first we have hidden order and patterns. So my example is something called a fractal. Specifically, this fractal is called the Mandelbrot set. You'll see over here, these are the mathematical equations that generate this thing you're looking at. It's worth noting that this thing was discovered, not made. So it wasn't just an artist made some patterns that look like what we're seeing. What we saw was that mathematicians discovered this, although it already existed long before math was around. So we see here, we're zooming in, we see all these spirals. Let me take a look at a still shot so we can really focus. We see, okay, there's this shape right here we start with. And as we zoom in, we see these two little circles. We zoom into the sides, and we see there's some structure. Zooming in further, we see these shapes, which look like seahorses, and indeed that's what mathematicians call them. They have their own curly tails, and the tails have their own whirlpool-type structure, which when we zoom in on, we see a little dot, which when we zoom in on that, we see is identical to the shape itself. So this is a property of fractals called self-similarity. That is, this tiny dot is identical to the whole fractal. That sounds impossible. How can something be a part of something be identical to the whole thing? And indeed, it is possible unless you have something infinitely complex, which fractals are. So I'll take you back to this slide again so we can see us zooming in to really get the effects of the self-similarity. Now, I'm cheating a little bit because this is an example of math and not physics. There is an interesting application of fractals to the study of galaxies. When you study the boundaries of galaxies, you'll see that they have some fractal properties. They're self-similar as well. So it isn't just math, though it's primarily math. But the reason why I show it is because it allows a good visualization of the beauty of the mathematics. Now, the mathematics, even without a visualization like we've shown here, I would argue is still beautiful, but you need a lot of expertise to be able to see it. For the ordinary person, you can't see the beauty because it's stuck in the heads of ugly mathematicians. but a fractal is this nice property where you can just look and see it. And so I compare this sometimes. The mathematician who really understands these things is something like Beethoven when in his later years he went deaf. And he still managed to compose some beautiful symphonies. So even though he couldn't hear the music, he could still in some way understand the beauty. And I think a lot of mathematics are beautiful, but fractals are particularly nice because the non-scientist can visualize that beauty. So that's what I have to say about fractals.
All right, so for hidden order of patterns, the patterns on these animals isn't hidden, but there's a way that they kind of allow us to see more interiorly to these animals. So there was a Swiss zoologist, by the name of Adolf Portmann, who published a book in 1967 called Hidden Order in Animal Patterns, and I'm forgetting the title of it. And it's really interesting what he wanted to do because he was trying to look at the reality of animal life kind of in a different way. And what he was trying to reveal was what is the inner life of different animals, kind of considering the hierarchy of being, right? Going from lower forms of animals to higher forms of animals. And he did this by looking more specifically at the brain, namely the cerebrum and the cerebellum and the brainstem, and then he reduces it a little bit more specifically to the brainstem because of some of the differences. But he's looking at the weight of the brain in relation to the weight of the brainstem and how the patterns of animals kind of reveal this inner life. And this inner life is based on how animals perceive their world, maybe how quickly and how intensely what the messages that they kind of gain, receive from through their senses travel through the body. And this is all points to the head, which that's because you have the life of the senses, locomotion, and nutrition collected in the head. And so for Portmann, what he sees, and he knows that it's not perfect, but what he sees is that as you move up through higher ranks of animals, you have what seems to be in kind of correlation with this index ratio of the weight of the brain in the brainstem. You have a larger index ratio, and then you also have greater distinction of the head pole, is what he calls it. And so what he does, he looks at a number of examples. So here, when you look at fish, the head is not really distinct in the same way as others. And so the patterns run equally from head to tail, and you kind of just look at the whole body. And so this shows that the kind of inner life of the animal is much less. And then he goes to mammals, and you have what he would call lower rank mammals. And so when you look at these mammals, you can see that there's nothing about the pattern that differentiates the head more distinctly than any other part of the body. So there's really no correlation between between the pattern and kind of the inner life, or like a particular part of the body, namely the head pole, being distinct and really standing out. And so in these mammals, like an armadillo or an eastern chipmunk, really the eye is drawn more to the patterns that are not at the head, but rather to behind the head, to the other parts of the body. But then when you go to the higher animals, like a Siberian tiger, you can see how the patterns accentuate not only the legs, but namely the head, because the pattern now changes when it gets to the head, whereas here the pattern is going straight through. It's pretty much the same through the whole body. And even here you might say, well, there's some coloration here that draws me to the head, but when you look at the dorsal fin and you look at the anal fin, you have really bright yellows that you're also drawn to as well. And then here with the chipmunk, the banding pattern here is much more grabbing than anywhere on the head. There's nothing about the head that really causes it to stand out. And the same thing with the banded armadillo. But when you come here, you can see the pattern now changes, and you're drawn to that real that head pole that accentuates this inner life of the animal. And then with the male mandrill, it's the same thing. Now, one thing he talks about is where you have bare patches on the body, which the mandrill has a bare patch on the rump. And then in the head, due to the blood vessels running through the face, you get this, and this is kind of an extreme example, you get the blue and the red, but then you also get the fur that's accentuated around the head, which is what you would get with horses and lions, and where you get manes that accentuate the head pole, giraffes, and then also any animals that have outgrowths of the head as well. And so here it's not so much that the pattern is hidden, rather the pattern reveals kind of this interior life of an animal that is kind of more intense in a way at higher levels than at lower animals. And what it does is what it really reveals the hierarchy of being that is taught to us from Aristotle all the way through Thomas. It's just kind of a new spin on it from Portman.
All right, so for our next category, we'll be talking about inner logic of systems and elegance. My example is something called string theory. Now, I have here a slide that I made for one of my classes showing a map of physics, showing different category of physics. I won't be going over the whole thing. I'm just showing it to you so you'll be prepared for the exam I'm giving you at the end of this talk. But we see different areas study things on different scales. So, for instance, quantum mechanics studies things that are really small. Special relativity studies things that are really fast. And so we have these different theories that describe different parts of reality quite well. But the current hunt right now is for something called a unified theory, which can describe all of reality with one story, one theory. The example I would give is the story of seven blind men who find an elephant. The first one grabs its leg and says it's a tree. One grabs its trunk and says it's a snake. One grabs its tusk and says it's a spear, and so on. So each one of these come up with a good description for the part of the elephant they're looking at. But then the seventh one, the wisest of the blind men, takes the accounts from the other six and says, what you've discovered is an elephant. And so that's what physics is looking for, that one unified theory that can describe everything on all scales, not just one part of it. And currently, our best candidate is something called string theory. Now, string theory is a little bit controversial. I would say about half of physicists accept it, and about half of physicists do not. So the basics of string theory is it describes all of the behavior that we see in all these different fields on every scale quite well with the motion of tiny vibrating strings. These strings are one-dimensional, but they're embedded in a 10-dimensional world, or 11 dimensions, depending on the variant of string theory. So this theory can describe up to 10^500 different possible universes, which is a huge number. It's mind-bogglingly large. And that creates a little bit of a problem, because any experiment we could do could be consistent with one of these different possible universes. So if we want to falsify it, if we want to do an experiment that could prove it false, we don't know how to do it, because we don't know which of these universes we're living in. So the problem is it can't be proved false with an experiment, which means we can't use the usual scientific method to test whether it's true or not. So some people are opposed to string theory because it can't be confirmed with the scientific method. Now, the ones who support it make the argument that we think it's true because it's beautiful. Now, I'm not going to take a stand on string theory one way or the other. I don't know whether it's true or not. But I do want to make the point that these scientists who are saying it's beautiful, I think, are right, and it is objectively beautiful. Now, it's worth noting that these are like mainstream secular scientists. These aren't just a few Thomistically minded people hidden away at Ave Maria University. These are mainstream secular scientists who are arguing for objective beauty, which ultimately points to an author of beauty, and the ultimate beauty, who is God, if they were to follow their argument, their logical conclusion. So that's what makes string theory interesting, is that we see, even among secular scientists, they're forced to acknowledge the objective idea of beauty. Now, as a final point on string theory, it's not entirely relevant, but it's very interesting. I have here the beginning of the Silmarillion, which was J.R.R. Tolkien's creation mythos. And in the Silmarillion, he has the Ainur, which are like the angels singing the universe into existence. Now, what is singing, or what is music in general? Well, it's vibrations and air molecules, which come from instruments or vocal cords, and these things are usually made up of vibrating strings. So if string theory is true, it is a neat way of viewing the universe, as the behavior of vibrating strings can be thought of as the ultimate symphony of the universe. So that's string theory.
And so remember that this part is the a little bit of elegance. If we go back, we're at inner logic of systems, and so here he's looking at the logic of this particular system, and elegance and inner logic kind of work together, which is why we merge these two categories. And so for me, if you kind of pick up a synonym of elegance and consider it as grandeur, which is a really great word to use when you're talking about the cosmos at large, the one thing that is difficult to for a lot of people when they move here from anywhere but South Florida is they look at South Florida merely as just a really hot, buggy swamp. And they don't see it, it's, you know, because I get students who are like, hey, we're going hiking, and they're like, this isn't a hike, this is a walk. And I'm like, okay, sorry it's not up a mountain. And, but it's still gonna be this really great hike. And we're gonna see the beauty of South Florida, that it's not just, of course, yes, it's hot and it's buggy, but it's so much more than that. And yes, it rains and we don't have the seasons, but we have wet season and we have dry season. And so there's a great elegance or a grandeur, and there's a logic to the system of the Everglades. And it's not random. Birds just don't show up out of nowhere or just randomly. Right now, we are transitioning from late wet, and now we've entered into, you could say, late wet, early dry, or just to say early dry. And what happens during wet season is that the marshes fill up with water, and then they flow nicely. That fresh water flows into the salt creeks in the marshes, and then out into the Gulf, or down into Florida Bay. And then as dry season comes around, the rains stop, the waters flow out of the marshes, they evaporate, the water percolates into the aquifer, and now the marshes are dry. Well, during the wet season, the fish were able to push in, and they were able to reproduce under a lot of cover for safety, and then food. And other things are laying eggs, like frogs are hatching, and snails, and so on and so forth. And so now, as the waters are coming down, we're entering into migration, and all these wading birds are coming through. And as the water comes down, it's easier for them to find food. And so then we have this amazing diversity of wading birds that are coming through. You can see them along oil well roads sometimes. I just saw 5 roseate spoonbills the other day in the ditch as we were driving down, and it was amazing. And they're able to find food, and then they are able to fill up and then continue on with migration later, and then the rains come back. And all of that is a system. Well, historically, what used to happen is water would fill up in Lake Okeechobee, and then it would overflow the southern rim of Lake O, flow through a pond apple forest, and then all the way down through the Sawgrass Plains, the Ridge and Slough, and then out through Shark Valley, and then come around into Florida Bay, and then you had water that would come down through Taylor Slough. And some of it would come into Big Cypress, but we're in the Big Cypress region, we're mostly rain-fed, we're not really fed by Lake O. Since then, we've modified it quite a bit, but it hasn't negated the beautiful logic of the Everglades system. And so when you step back, with my students, what we do is we look at all of these different ecosystems that change based on inches. So you go up 3, 4, 5 inches, and you're literally in a different ecosystem. But for most people, you go up 3 or 4 inches, and you're in the same ecosystem. You go up 100 feet, and you're in the same ecosystem. But here, that's not the case. And so when they step back and they see this mosaic of ecosystems, that it's part of a larger system that has this beautiful harmony of things being timed up such that birds come through to be able to find food at the right time, the waters rise, and so then fish can reproduce. And it works its way year after year after year so that the water that is the lifeblood of the Everglades is able to do its work in and out of the year. And so this is a good example of the logic of the system that is easily missed if you're kind of overwhelmed by heat and mosquitoes. But when you step back and you see it and you realize that there's a great design and logic to that design, then you realize that there's a great beauty to that. So what about asymmetry?
Yeah, so I have your two paintings, one by Pablo Picasso called The Portrait of Olga, and one by Raphael called the Sistine Madonna. Now, the interesting thing worth noting about this paper that Professor Feger brought up was that both physicists and biologists noted asymmetry as by far the least important aspect of beauty. Now, why is that interesting? Well, the modernist and postmodernist art movements have had asymmetry as a very large part of the art. Now, there's various motivations for this for various artists, but as a collective, part of it is a rebellion against a universe where there's objective order established by an objective creator. And so we go from beautiful paintings that look like this, where there's symmetry not only in the faces and the bodies of the people who are being painted, but also in the structure of the painting itself, to this hideous thing. And what we see is that there is real objective beauty. And when we see beauty, when we see something like this, it can point us towards the mind of God. So we see effectively that scientists, without having been taught this, have sort of a traditional understanding of beauty, which points ultimately to the author of beauty.
Yeah, I think one thing that's important too is when you look at Olga, there's, for most people, there's probably a bit of a sense of like revulsion, right? Where you're just kind of like, oh, there's not something right about that. And I provide a similar example with students. Like if you were to look at a oak tree that's half dead with brown leaves and the life is just not in it, but then you look at a full oak tree in full bloom and all the birds are in it, if somebody were to say, yeah, that oak tree that's half dead is more beautiful than the oak tree that's not, I mean, at first, you look at the half-dead oak tree, and there's something like, ah, there's something wrong with that tree, right? And then you look at the full oak tree, and you're like, yeah, that's really beautiful. I don't think anybody would say that the dead oak tree or half-dead oak tree is more beautiful. And so there's something in us that recognizes something that's asymmetrical or something that is lacking of sorts. Okay, so when in doubt, ite ad tomum, so go to Thomas, right? So, Tom, what is beauty? Well, in the Summa Theologiae, Thomas says, beautiful things are those which please when seen. And I think when you look at Olga, she's not as pleasing as the Madonna, right? Or a half-dead oak tree and a live oak tree. And so that's kind of that natural disposition, I think, that most people have to things that are beautiful or less beautiful. Well, if we live, like Dr. Sadasivan was saying, in this kind of idea that beauty is in the eye of the beholder, then somebody could say, like, well, you can't tell me that the Madonna is more beautiful than Olga, because I think Olga is more beautiful than the Madonna. But you could say, well, there really are three objective criteria to beauty that Thomas utilizes in his corpus of work. And these are integritas, consonantia, and claritas, or integrity or wholeness, harmony or proportion, and splendor or radiance. And so are these visible in the previous examples that Dr. Sadasivan and I have provided for you this afternoon? And I think when you look at our examples, you see all of this, that there's a wholeness or an integrity to each of the aspects. When you look at, let's say, the Everglades, for example, there's integrity to each of the parts, that they're working and they're functioning properly, they're integral, they're integrated, properly integrated. And even in the examples that he provides with physics, that each part is playing its proper role kind of in a perfect way. And then harmony or proportion, Olga is not properly proportioned, and which is why there's something that's lacking there. And then splendor or radiance, which really that splendor kind of jumps out at you when the integrity and the harmony or the proportion are all there, then like I tell my students that you see the integrity of the parts of the Everglades system and you realize that there's a proportion in the way that things work, or there's a harmony to it, then there's a clarity that it becomes clearer to you, right? It radiates a greater goodness and beauty, which is the same thing with the examples that Dr. Sadasivan provided with physics. And in an asymmetry, it's lacking. Now, any created thing has a degree of beauty, it's just how much, right? So what effect did beauty have on the physicists and the biologists? Well, they said, regarding beauty, they felt a sense of clarity in the things that they, when they saw how things fit together. And there were other responses that they provided, but this one was, I think, most apropos to the topic today, that there was a clarity that jumped out at them when they see that things are properly functioning and they understand the parts and it becomes more intelligible to them. But they also found thrill and delight and joy, right? And delight and joy are proper responses to beautiful things. And so ultimately, the biggest result that Vadyanathan and Alia found was that the physicists and the biologists had greater meaning in their life. And the reason that they did this study was because there have been a number of studies coming out, especially since COVID, to show the mental the lack of mental good mental health in the sciences because of all the pressures that are in, especially mainstream science, like your big research institutions and all the pressures that are on scientists to constantly publish and bring in grant money and bring in students and all this thing. And so even in the face of mental stress, the beauty in their work lifted, kind of elevated them and gave them greater meaning in their life. Well, why does beauty give greater meaning to our life? Well, Thomas says that existence, form, and action are the ground of beauty, right? So anything that's in existence has a form, right, or a nature, right? And you can't have a form or a nature without being in existence. And then these things are, moving from potency into act. And then something cannot give itself its own existence, right? We don't just make ourselves exist, but rather our existence is received from our parents and their parents and their parents, and you go all the way back to a first cause, right, which is God. And so God grants things being, and they participate in his being. And so God is holding everything in being at every single moment, and if he didn't, then it wouldn't exist. And so everything that physicists and biologists are studying is being held in existence by God, who is being itself, and they are studying the created effects of God because they are all created things. And Thomas says that God creates a variety of things because they reveal his goodness. And not any one thing can reveal his goodness whatsoever. So God creates a multitude of things to reveal his goodness. All right, so every created thing is good and has an aspect of beauty, because beauty and goodness go together. And so beauty of created things reveals the goodness and beauty of God, who is the ultimate meaning of our existence and the true source of our happiness, which is why in the face of mental stress, they can find meaning in their life through their work. So why is this important to the natural sciences? The role of the natural sciences is to reveal more deeply the beauty, goodness, and truth of God's created effects. So for us, biology and physics provides a unique and powerful way for people to perceive God's invisible nature in the things that have been made, right? So it's a true work of Romans 1:20 that we are able to do in the sciences to reveal that goodness and that beauty of the Creator. So with that, I thought that we could just end with a short prayer. This is from St. Augustine's Easter sermon from 411. And so St. Augustine ends that a very short sermon on beauty. He says, "O God, you are never far from those who sincerely search for you. Accompany those who err and wander far from you. Turn their hearts towards what is right and let them see the signs of your presence in the beauty of created things." Thank you.